Hi, I am Ethan Jake Townsend, junior at Clear Creek Baptist Bible College, and this is our counseling sessions that I'm doing for the class. I have Megan, my wife, will be my parishioner today. She will be playing the part of Aubrey. So, as an overview of our first session, we encounter some of the problems that were going on. Aubrey is having trouble with forgiveness. More specifically, it is in forgiving her mother. After a rough childhood of abuse and trouble in the home, Aubrey had a lot of resentment to her mother. At 18, she left home, and over the next 4 years, she wasn't in communication with her mother. And when she came back, once she became saved, she has feeling these convictions that she needs to forgive her mother. And in doing so, she also wanted to reach out to her mother. So she came to me because of the desire to have that communication with her. And she wanted to kind of discuss what would be a good way to kind of reach that point of forgiveness and to grow in her relationship with her mother again. So the next time we'll come back on, we're going to pick off where we left off for the first session. And we're going to dive into more of the problems and focus on the focal point of the conviction that she feels in forgiving her mother and the desire she has to kind of rekindle a relationship that had been broken since she was 18 and being 4 years later. So Aubrey will be back in the very next session. Thank you. Hello, Aubrey.
Hello.
How have you been?
Been doing good. How about you?
Well, I'm fine. Thanks for asking. So, how'd this week go?
It went okay. I called my mom and asked if she wanted to meet for lunch.
All right.
And it was kind of awkward, but she did say that she noticed something different about me. That I was happier, and I guess she was kind of wondering why I was so willing to reach out to her after all these years. And I told her that I got saved, and she kind of laughed at that. We didn't really talk about it.
Okay. Now, when you grew up with her, I'm kind of seeing maybe she wasn't churchgoer.
No, we never went to church. The neighbors took me to church quite a bit and kept me involved. But she never would go. And then in my teen years, I fell out of church.
Okay. How old were you when you fell out of church?
I was about 15.
Okay. You talked a little bit earlier about when you left. And you said you were 18 and, you know, obviously young. But tell me about how that went. We didn't get to talk a whole lot about that last time.
The way that I left home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, one day while she was at work, I just packed up all my stuff and I left. She didn't know that I was making plans to move in with a friend of mine.
Okay. Did things just get so bad that...
It did. The verbal abuse really got to where I was considering taking my own life if I didn't get out of there.
Oh, okay. Well, that's pretty strong stuff. How long did those feelings...
Probably from the time I was 15 to the time I was 18.
Okay. Did you feel better once you were able to get out of the situation?
I did. At first, when I left, I was really confused and really emotional. Like, everything was really heavy. Yeah. I didn't know if I made the right decision. But when I left, after some time, just being around my friends and stuff, I really started to feel better.
All right. And before we started to make these changes... How were you feeling? Obviously, there was that four-year period. Did you ever have an experience that you wanted to reach back out to her in between those times?
I did, like at holidays and stuff, yeah. When I missed my family and I missed being at home. But I knew that it probably wasn't good for me to get back, pull back into that environment.
Okay. So we were able to make some contact. And that's really good. I'm glad to hear that. Now, obviously, it didn't go exactly the way that we wanted it to. How are you holding up through that aspect of it?
I'm just really keeping my scripture close, and I'm just praying and stuff and trying to just really cling to Jesus during all this. And I know that she's responding the way that she's responding because she's lost.
Okay. Okay. Did she act like she wanted to have any more conversation going forward?
She did, but when we started talking, you know, she made it sound like, well, I'm the one that left home. I'm the one that cut the communication. It's my fault.
Do you agree?
To a certain extent, but I feel like if I didn't get out of there, then it probably would have not ended up good for me.
I understand. Sometimes getting away does help. Obviously, young, I know that's been difficult and very hard on you. But going back and kind of looking and see where you've come, you've obviously been able to kind of stabilize yourself and kind of be able to take care of yourself at this point. And you're safe. One thing that we wouldn't want to see is that, you know, we get back into a situation where, well, we do feel kind of overwhelmed by those things. The most central thing that we talked about was going to be an aspect of forgiveness. And then the other thing we wanted to work on after that is in that relationship. Now, the relationship side of it may or may not come. And I do think that's one thing that we have to kind of be prepared for. How do you feel, as far as the relationship is going right now, how do you feel that you're going to be able to move forward with that? Or do you think there's a possibility of that?
I really don't know. I know that I have to get myself close enough to her so that I can eventually learn to forgive and to start this forgiveness process. But I don't really see that she's going to be in my life, because I just don't think that she's going to want to be in my life.
I understand.
Not positively, anyway.
I understand. Obviously, haven't been through the type of situation that you have, but everybody does deal with struggles within families. And it's not uncommon today to see so many broken homes and see so many situations where people feel overwhelmed or feel like they're stuck in certain situations. And I'm definitely glad that you felt at least comfortable enough to come forward and talk about these things. One thing that we do want to kind of look at is within the forgiveness aspect of it, there's only so much of that that you'll be able to control. We can't, and one thing that I've always said is you can't make people do the right things. So if she doesn't do things that are expected of you, if she doesn't respond in the ways that you would hope, don't be discouraged. We're gonna focus mainly on what we can do, as I kind of talked with you a little bit about in the first section. Now, you mentioned a lot about wanting to forgive her, and you've said a couple times that the Bible tells you to forgive. Now, when did you start learning these things? When did that start sinking in?
Well, it was at a sermon at my church just a few weeks ago that my pastor was preaching, and he was preaching on the importance of forgiveness. And just something that, you know, really stuck out to me was the verse where he read where Jesus couldn't forgive me if I didn't forgive others. And, you know, that was just really heavy on me, because I know I've done terrible things in my past, and I know that I'm a sinner and saved by grace, and I know that I need God's forgiveness just as desperately as anyone. But when I compare my sin to my mom's, you know, I look at it like it's not on an even playing field. I look at it like what she did to me are just so much more worse than things that I've done. But when I break it down, that's not what Scripture says. Scripture says that, you know, God sees us on an equal playing field, and our sin is sin. And I know that I have to forgive her. I have to see it that way. And I guess that's the thing that I'm having the most trouble with, is seeing that really the things that I've done, the things that she's done, neither one of them are right in God's eyes. And I have to be able to forgive her to move forward in my Christian walk. I really feel like that this is something that God is really calling me to work on.
Okay. That's really good. We all are going to struggle with things a little differently. And the way that we're going to kind of process through this information is going to be a little differently. And I do feel that you've got a decent spiritual place that you can kind of take yourself to that spot that you would like to be at. Do you remember what verse in scripture that he preached out of?
I don't.
It sounds a lot like Colossians. I'm going to turn there. I want to read that with you real quick. Okay. I've also got some things that I would like for you to read that can kind of help you out a little bit. And you're right about forgiveness being something that is God definitely wants us to do. And the Bible does teach, actually in First Colossians chapter 3, let's see here, and starting in verse 13, it says, "Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you." The Bible teaches that the way that Christ forgave us, and he died while we were still sinners, that we have that same obligation to forgive others in that same manner, in that same demeanor. And it's really good to see that you're really longing to do that. How do you think you can make that happen? I know you feel that you want to do it, but how do you think that you can really put that into action?
I feel like, in a way, even though I really don't want a close relationship with her, because I know that with her not changing, I feel like all that toxic stuff is going to come back on me. But I feel like God is really calling me to love her and tell me that the forgiveness is going to come that way. But it is so hard. It's so hard to say that. I mean, I do love her as a person because she's my mom, but it's so hard to have those feelings of being connected because of the things that she did to me as a child.
Right. I definitely moving in the right direction there. One thing to do keep in mind is that sometimes this does take time. And although that you definitely want to forgive, and I want you to be able to get to that point too. Trying to forget the things that have happened might be a little bit more difficult. One way that I've always viewed forgiveness is not in the means of simply being able to forget, but it means that you can't hold against them what they've done in any way, shape, or form. So somebody reach out with a hug or a handshake, you don't slap that away because one day 5 years ago you spilled my Coke. And some people hold grudges that severely. I've had people that come for counseling and that come to talk, and they're so far away from forgiveness, they wouldn't have even been able to say, "I need to forgive." So simply being able to come up with the statement that I do need to forgive and it's healthy for me to forgive is definitely moving in the right direction. I wrote down another verse to kind of share with you here. Let's flip over here. Do you have any verses that you've been reading?
I've been reading a lot just in the book of Matthew recently.
Okay, the book of Matthew. There's a lot of really, really good stories. Mm-hmm. A lot of times where Christ is seeing the interactions of people around him and noticing their lack of forgiveness one for another. And that definitely shows its face a lot. 21:18. This is Matthew 18:21, and it talks about Peter. It says, "And Peter came to Jesus and asked, 'Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me?' And he says, 'Up to 70 times. It's a question. Or up to 7 times, I'm sorry. And Jesus answered, "I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. And what Jesus is telling him here is that we can't put a pneumatic possession to forgiveness. There's not a level of forgiveness that when it becomes so much that you have to stop and say, "I can't forgive this person anymore." Now, there might still be an element of feeling that and feeling that betrayal, that hurt that's there. But the option to forgive still has to proceed even past that. So Tell me again about future conversations with her.
Well, I was thinking about sending her a card or a gift with Mother's Day coming up. And but part of me just, when I think about how there are so many women that deserve, you know, Mother's Day gifts and stuff like that, she's not one of the first that come to mind. You know, I've had a lot of really influential women in my life who I consider more of a mother than her. And when I think about sending that, I think my pride is really trying to stop me, because I'm like, I don't want to show her that type of love. But that was something that I was hoping to try to work towards, since we only have a few weeks.
Well, no matter what, no matter how bad she acts or treats you, she's still going to be your mother. And that's one thing that we'll say. I definitely want you to kind of work through these things as much as you can. But one thing that will not change is that she will be your mother. Now, do tell me about these other figures that you speak of.
Well, I had several people in the church growing up who were very strong. Women my eyes, very influential. I had a Sunday school teacher that I thought dearly of. One of the ladies that helped run our youth department before I fell out of church. They were very dear to me. And neighbors growing up, we had a lot of neighbors who kept in touch with us. And, you know, they say it takes a village to raise a child. I remember a lot of these women being very prominent in my childhood.
Good. It's important that if you're not getting those figures from those that we need to be those figures, that we're still getting that from somewhere else. So that kind of helps me kind of shape the image of what made you the woman that you are today. Have you had any of these other darker feelings that you talked about it last time, about maybe hurting yourself or hurting others and really taking that stuff personally. Over the last few months or a year or so, have you felt that way at all?
No, I'm really kicked that depression, thankfully. Now, before I got saved, I didn't have those feelings of like suicide, but I was still pretty depressed. And I still struggle with occasional depression when it comes to like this, but it's nowhere near what it was.
Okay.
My perspective on life has changed since I got saved.
That's great. That's one thing that as ministers we'd like to see people that when they take that step of faith, do we actually see any fruit that comes along with it? And some people take more time than others, and we try not to be too, you know, with a magnifying glass trying to figure out if these people are really moving in the right direction. But for you, it seems like it was a pretty steep change, pretty quick. Have you struggled at all with that at all? I mean, trying to leave your past life, those desires and those feelings, and to just try to turn a new leaf.
I did in the beginning, but since I've been away from home for 4 years, though I wasn't saved and I probably wasn't around the best company in these 4 years, and I wasn't going down the path that I was going down, and I didn't have some of the people in my life. I still had, you know, some of these good figures that I've known throughout my life that I've kept in contact with. So I really feel like that helped me. It wasn't like a night and day change. It wasn't, you know, like super quick or anything. I just felt God working on me. A friend of mine had invited me to church, starting with church functions and stuff. And I felt like, okay, maybe I need to be here. Maybe I need to serve here. And just a year ago when I got saved is really when I feel like I started to have these feelings of wanting to reconnect, but I just kept kind of, you know, suppressing those because I really didn't want to go back down this path.
Are those people that you were around then, are they around today?
The ones that were very influential in my...
The ones that weren't.
Oh, no, I was not in a very good relationship. I had a boyfriend at a time who, he wasn't abusive or mean or anything like that. It's just we were living outside of what God had intended for marriage, and I know that wasn't healthy. And he was pretty not really hot or cold on the subject. He just really wasn't interested in church. And I know that I had to get that relationship out of the way. That was a big thing for me. And I've had friends that I've known all through school. Some of them are saved, some of them aren't. Really, I've been trying to distance myself. I have a new job where I work at a Mother's Day Out, and I have a lot of friends who are saved and they're Christians. And so the crowd that I've run with has changed. So that's helped me quite a bit.
Do you open up to anyone else about these problems?
I do. I have a friend who I talk to that I work with about some of the stuff that I've been going through, but it's hard. Some of it's like a really raw subject because they have such great moms, and you know, it kind of hurts for me to talk about some of that stuff because I don't want to, you know, get to crying and, you know, all this other stuff. But the friend that I have kind of opened up to, she has like not a really bad relationship with her mom like I had, but it's not the best. So she's kind of, she understands what I've been going through.
Good. Good. It's important that when we do run to the end of this counseling, that we have other people that can kind of help us out. Mm-hmm. What about, I know you go to church in town. What about there? Are they offering anything or any kind of like single women's retreats, anything that could keep you occupied, anything that could, you know, give you that little bit of support there?
Well, there are, they've done like a single moms event, and they have some singles classes and stuff like that. And I haven't really got way too involved. There's just so many people, and I love my church, but at times I kind of feel like a number because there's so much going on. There's stuff going on here and here and here. And I'm thinking, you know, well, who will have time to sit down and talk to me?
I got you. Well, that's one thing that we'll look at a little bit more towards the end of our sessions. Mm-hmm. We definitely need to figure out a way that we're able to, if we're not able to handle all these problems within ourselves, we definitely have some strong support people there that can help us. And lady mother figures that you had before, are they still available?
They are. I haven't spoken to them in a little while, but I'm sure I could reach out and they'd be available to talk to.
Do you think that they would be available to help?
I'm sure they would.
Okay. Sometimes people don't ask and they kind of hem themselves off from the world that's around them, and all they had to do was just ask. Mm-hmm. And people would be more than happy to help. Most people have a desire to help. So those people that are around you, don't be afraid. Just like you weren't afraid to reach out for these sessions, don't be afraid to reach out to those around you and ask for a little bit of help that might be able to help you in the future. Now, another thing that we talked about last week was on our forgiveness process is to try to let go some of the things that had happened in the past. How do you feel that has gone this week?
Seeing my mom was kind of hard because it brought back a lot of those memories. So for the first couple of days, I was thinking, what have I done? Why have I done this? And you know, is this a good decision? Because I get to think about all these bad memories and all these hard times that I've endured. But then Jesus kind of grounds me and brings me back, and he's like, you're doing this because I asked you to do this. And you know, I go back to that sermon at church that my pastor preached, and it helps kind of ground me and remind me why I'm doing what I'm doing, or why I'm trying to do it anyway.
One thing that we will definitely want to keep an eye on is with every feeling that we have, like seeing your mom and spending that time after 4 years, it's the first time you've seen her in four years, it's going to trigger feelings and emotion. And then those feelings and emotions are going to trigger a lot of thoughts. Mm-hmm. And a lot of things are going on within our minds, and we're processing all this information. And then, once those feelings and emotions and thoughts have brewed, we have actions and behavior that responds to that. Now, we need to make sure that we're bringing in the right information and the right feelings, as positive as we can be, and try to take them as rationally and not be as emotional as some of our responses might want to be. So it kind of helped me out here. Do we have any kind of like anger? Did you feel?
I definitely have anger.
Resentment? Was there any positive things like joy, happiness?
It was good to see her, but at the same time that it wasn't. So I can't say there was totally no joy, because I did have that small, feeling of joy when I first saw her face for the first time, but I was also really nervous too.
Okay. Well, nervous is also a feeling. So we're all kind of taking in all of the events that are taking place there. One thing that we want to work on together is paying attention to how we're getting caught up or emotionally engaged in things, and to think of things in a level of what I can control. Because again, we're going to be in our own bubble, in our own area here, and we're going to have to work on forgiving, but those emotions really play havoc with our ability to do that. Because if I look at somebody that hurt me, I'm immediately going to jump to the feeling of anger. And I'm gonna think about those things that have happened, and then I'm gonna run and respond. And sometimes I respond in not a good way. We don't want to, go hurting anybody. Mm-hmm. And we don't want to put ourselves back in a position that we were in the past. Mm-hmm. So what we can do there is to try to catch it before it gets to that point. If you feel that future meetings with her, if she's available for it. And you can kind of work with yourself to be thinking of these things in a way that allows forgiveness to actually be forgiveness. Because when we go out and spend time with this, with your mother, if the first thing that pops into my mind is all the bad things that have happened, we're not forgiving. And I just want you to be aware of that. Now, this is a process, so it's not going to be an everyday thing. But what we want to see is that over time, that we are able to think less about all of those bad things and think more about all of those good things. So again, just like this, the passage that I gave you. This
and
is,
that's Colossians?
This is, well, Matthew 18.
Oh, Matthew 18. Okay, I'm going to write that down.
21 and 22. It says that when Peter came to Jesus, he said, "How many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sinned against me?" And he says, this is Peter asking, "Up to 7 times. And Jesus responds, he says, "I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. So it's a multiplication effect. It just keeps growing more and more and more. The more that somebody hurt you, the more that we forgive them. Now, forgiveness is the separation of the emotion that you want to respond to that, and allowing it to act as if they didn't do it. Mm-hmm. And that's hard, because we're going to remember what they've done, but that there has to be a disengagement in order for forgiveness to take place. So we need to work on a way that you can do that, and we need to figure out a way that takes place. Now, in this same chapter, in chapter 18, there's a wonderful story about forgiveness. And we've still got a little bit of time before our session is over, so I'd like to read that with you, okay? Now, and as I read this, you might want to spend time this week just kind of reading over this account, because it's gonna help more than you think it is. And also, I want to give you a book as well. So before you leave, Charles Stanley, a minister, wrote a book called The Gift of Forgiveness. And I think that it would be very nice if over the next few weeks you spent reading that work.
Okay.
I think that it's a great book on forgiveness. I think it's really going to help you. So let's read this scripture here. So it says, "Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with her servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. "Be patient with me," he begged, "and I will pay back everything." The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when the servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins, again, much less than the bags of gold. He grabbed him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, "Be patient with me, and I will pay it back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then their master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I canceled all the debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had mercy on you?" In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. This is how the Heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brothers or sisters from your heart. Forgiveness is really, really important. And we see in that story how one person had the heart of forgiveness and the other person didn't. Now, I'm also a believer that in spiritual gifts. And as a new Christian, the book of Corinthians talks about spiritual gifts. And I believe that forgiveness is one of those gifts. Some people have it, and they're really good at forgiving people. Okay, so after me and Aubrey had 5 sessions, at the end of the 5th session, we decided to end and terminate our sessions going forward. We do feel that she's going to be capable of handling these situations going forward. Not all of the situations, all the feelings that she had are completely gone. She still has a little bit of resentment, but she's come a long way from where we first started. We don't feel the need to refer her to anybody else. She feels pretty confident going forward that she'll be able to handle these things. We found a singles group within her church that she's going to that will give her a little bit of support and help her with that independency that she needs. She definitely wants her mother to be involved, and her mother has become more susceptible to spending time with her. They've been talking a lot more, which is great. Going forward, though, it might not be one of those things they spend a whole lot of time together, but Aubrey has definitely come to grips with that. I did let her know that she's available to come and speak with me if she needed to, or we needed to have further sessions, but as of right now, we feel that we've made good progress going forward. She does have some, that one book that we spoke about during our sessions. She's been reading out of it, and she finds a lot of things helpful for her there. She's been reading in scripture. We felt that because of her spiritual position and how far she's come, that it's really not going to be, you know, that much of an issue for her to handle these things on her own. And that's our biggest worry, because she did come from a past that was pretty troubled, but we feel that she's going to be more than happy, more than capable of handling those things. So that ends our counseling session. And I hope all the other students do really well. And it's been nice to meet everybody. Most people don't get to see us face to face because we are online students. So Jake Townsend, signing off. Okay. So after me and Aubrey had 5 sessions, at the end of the 5th session, we decided to end and terminate our sessions going forward. We do feel that she's going to be capable of handling these situations going forward. Not all of the situations, all the feelings that she had are completely gone. She still has a little bit of resentment, but she's come a long way from where we first started. We don't feel the need to refer her to anybody else. She feels pretty confident going forward that she'll be able to handle these things. We found a singles group within her church that she's going to that will give her a little bit of support and help her with that independency that she's she needs. She definitely wants her mother to be involved, and her mother has become more susceptible to spending time with her. They've been talking a lot more, which is great. Going forward, though, it might not be one of those things they spend a whole lot of time together, but Aubrey has definitely come to grips with that. I did let her know that she's available to come and speak with me if she needed to, or we needed to have further sessions, but as of right now, we feel that we've made good progress going forward. She does have some that one book that we spoke about during our sessions. She's been reading out of it, and she finds a lot of things helpful for her there. She's been reading in scripture. We felt that because of her spiritual position and how far she's come, that it's really not going to be, you know, that much of an issue for her to handle these things on her own. And that's our biggest worry, because she did come from a past that was pretty troubled, but we feel that she's going to be more than happy, more than capable of handling those things. So that ends our counseling session. And I hope all the other students do really well. And it's been nice to meet everybody. Most people don't get to see us face to face because we are online students. So Jake Townsend, signing off.